Thank you, Kyle, for the introduction and also for the invitation. I am very happy to be here today. And what I would like to show you are a couple of projects going on in our group in Madrid. So the first one is dealing with the Spanish monitoring program in air based on PAS, on passive air samplers. And I'm very lucky because this morning Heidi was explaining a little bit all the basis of the global monitoring plan. So I assume that you are now very familiar with this kind of project, but I would like to show you some preliminary results in our country. Then I will move to another approach based on the use of white storks as bioindicators. So, you all are familiar with the Stockholm Convention, and Article 16 states that the effectiveness should be evaluated. So this is the reason of the Spanish National Implementation Plan, and the main objective of this project is to establish a national monitoring network on air based on passive air samplers. And the idea is that this should allow us to evaluate if the measures taken are effective. So the strategy, as I said, is based on passive sampling in air, and we started now, I don't remember, Esteban, 5 years ago, in 2008, sorry. And the idea is to have a long-term and stable program using a wide geographical distribution, controlling both remote and urban areas. And the core matrix are the air samplers. We are collaborating with another group in Spain, the group of CEMAT. But what I would like to show you today are the results from the CSIC group, okay? So the target analyzed in our Spanish monitoring plan are some chlorinated pesticides, DDTs, HCB and HEH. Then for PCBs, we are considering both dioxin-like and multi-ortho PCBs, also PVDs, and also all the 2, 3, 7, 8 dioxin and furan. Well, I don't need to explain so much. I didn't know Heidi was explaining all this morning, so you are now familiar with the passive air samplers. You can see the foam here, where we collect the analytes. And for the sampling site, as I said, the remote stations are located always at the EMIP location in Spain. So you can see here in the map, in red colors are all the sampling points where our group is doing all the monitoring. We have 4 cities, in Barcelona, La Coruña, Huelva and Azpeitia, and then we have 6 remote places almost on the coastal side, in the case of our group. And then in green color, you have all the stations which are under the monitoring of the CEMAT group. What we are doing in our program is to deploy 4 PAF discs per sampling point every 3 months. This is a little bit different from the program Heidi was explaining this morning. And normally, we use 3 PAFs for dioxin analysis, and then the other one is used for the other analyte. For dioxin and furan analysis, we have been collaborating with the group of Esteban Abad, but recently we have been starting with the new DFH instrument, and I hope we will be able to produce our data maybe within the next coming months, I don't know yet. We are getting familiar with the instrument now. I would like to say also that We are collaborating with other international networks. So in this sampling point, maybe some of you have been to Spain, to the south, a beautiful place, Doñana National Park. And in this point, we are deploying also the samplers for the GAPS program from Tom Harner from Environment Canada. And we also have been collaborating just for a couple of years with the Monet Europe program. In this case, this program is working in a different way, and they only take 28 days of exposure. Anyway, we have, as I said, in this case, we have been collaborating for a couple of years. We have been deploying the passive samplers, but we are still waiting for the data from both groups. So. Well, I'm not going to explain so much about sample preparation. I just would like to say that the whole day we have been talking about solid samples, a lot of food and feed samples. But when you are working with air samples, I would say that this could be complicated, especially when you have to work with the blank. You normally get a lot of contamination in the lab, and I don't like this. Anyway, you have to deal with this problem. Well, for the instrumental analysis, we are using different instruments depending on the analyte. So for the dioxin and furans, we are collaborating with Esteban with the DFS instruments. Then for the PVDs and DPs, we normally use single quadrupoles, and for the chlorinated pesticides, we also use the micro detection, micro electron capture detection. Well, now let's see some of the preliminary results. I would like to say that we only have now data for 4 years, not so much in order to see temporal trends, but I am very happy that now we can see something in this short period of time. So in general, what we can see in this table is that dioxin and furans always, as normally, have the lowest levels. You can see we are here in the range of 2 to 300 femtograms per cubic meters. And normally, you also can see that levels in general are always higher in urban sites compared to remote sites. Then, if we move to PCBs or PVDs, levels are always quite much more higher than levels found for dioxin and furan. So, here we have the congener profile for dioxin and furans. And you can see that normally, considering both the cities and the remote sites, the congener profile is always dominated by the OCDD. One more thing you can see here is that it is quite particular to see that in Barcelona, the contribution of the OCDD is quite high. Maybe Esteban could explain something more about this, I don't know. Then, if we compare the profile, both in the cities and the remote sites, you can see that they are quite similar independently of the sampling year. Considering the whole period of study between the summer 2008 and the summer 2012, for dioxin and furans, you can see that levels are always quite similar, and generally in urban location, levels are slightly higher, but not so much. The good news is that we could say that dioxin and furan levels in the air, in the Spanish environment, are quite low, and this is good news. For PCBs, if we have a look at the congener profile, you can see that it is also quite similar both on the cities and the remote sites. But when we compare the sampling years, it is quite particular to see that in 2012, the contribution for the coplanar PCBs was a little bit higher than in previous year. I don't know why. But for the remaining years, all the profiles are quite similar. And in this case, we are talking about levels higher than those for diogenes and furans. And it is very nice to see how, for both the cities and the remote sites, in general, levels for diogenes-like PCBs show a clear tendency to decrease. This is quite nice, even if we have to be careful because we are only considering a 4-year sampling. Now, if we move to the PVDEs, you can see that in general, the congener profile, here you have all the congeners we are analyzing, also the DICA VDE. And this was always the dominant congener. It is also very nice to see that, well, nice, not nice at all, but because you can see here that when we move from 2008 to 2012, BD209 levels are normally increasing, while the low brominated are decreasing. And here you can see better how, in general, if we focus only on the BD209, you can see how levels are generally increasing, especially in the remote areas compared to the cities. Well, now we will move to a different approach. In this case, we will not consider an abiotic matrix like here, but a biotic matrix. And I would like to show you a few data about a small study from my student, Juan Muñoz. This is part of his PhD thesis. So, in this case, the idea of this project was to use the white stork as bioindicator. Why this species? Well, there are a few good reasons. One of them is that this species, I assume you know, you all know this species, very well known everywhere in the world. This is supposed to be on the top of the food web, so we expect a high bioaccumulation and bioconcentration of the contaminants if we use eggs. Also, it is very important to know that normally they are long lifespan organisms. Some of them could live about 25 years. Most of them now are getting sedentary in our study area, and we also have a good knowledge about the feeding habits of this species. So this is a more recent study than the air study, so the idea was to investigate, of course, the legacy contaminants, but also emerging POPs, including also the chlorine plus, which is becoming an environmental problem now. So here is the study area. So in Madrid, we have been collaborating with a professor from the Faculty of Biology, and we were able to get 10 examples from in 2005, and then in 2011, we were able to collect 14 examples. In the case of the sampling point in Doñana National Park in the south of Spain, we got 23x of samples in the period 1999-2001, and then we were able to get 10 samples in 2010. Well, I'm explaining this because working with the wildlife samples is not as easy as working with food or feed. In that case, you can get whatever you want, the amount of sample you want, but when you are working in the field with wildlife species, you are always dependent on the species, on the people working in the field. So it's not that easy to get the amount of samples you really want to get. But anyway, I think it is quite important and nice to be able to get data from other kind of environmental issues, not only focused on humans, but also on wildlife. So now let's move to some results. For PCBs, you can see again the good news we had with their samples, and you can see how both in the protected area in Doñana National Park, PCB levels decreased from 2000 to 2007. You can see the decrease ratio of about 6.0. And also in Madrid, we found a good decrease ratio in the case of the whole PCBs. However, what I would like to remark is that it is quite strange that even if Doñana National Park is a protected area, by the beginning of the 2000s, we were finding always high levels of PCBs. But not only on this kind of samples, also when we were analyzing soils other kind of biological samples, because we have been working for a long time with many wildlife species. So we don't know the origin of this PCB contamination. I would like to investigate more, because it's not normal to find this high contamination. I don't know if it is because Doñana is quite close to the African countries. I don't know what is the reason. So for DDTs, again, we have a quite similar behavior as for PCBs. You can see that by the 2000 in Doñana National Park, DDT levels were really high. But fortunately, decreasing in 2010, and in Madrid, we also found a decrease when comparing 2011 to 2005. Again, I would like to remark that this is a very particular place, because by the end of the 90s, we found high DDT levels, not in biological samples, but also in soil samples. And when we talk about DDTs, we are talking about the main compounds, DDT, but also the metabolites. And the case for the soils is that we found the original compounds, the DDT, not the DDE. And this is also another quite strange situation. Well, finally, for dioxinfurans, again, we have the good news that levels are decreasing. You can see how both in Doñana National Park and Madrid, the median levels are very low. But now we found the contrary situation. We move to the PBDs. You can see how both in Doñana National Park and Madrid, PBD levels are increasing. And also, we find the same situation if we focus on DP, and you can see again how are decreasing. Well, in the case of PBDs, this could be normal because it depends on the regulation, and some of them are very recent. In the case of DP, we are still looking for some kind of regulation for this compound. Finally, in terms of toxicity, the good news is that total TEQs, both in Madrid and Doñana National Park, are quite low now. So, as general conclusions regarding POPs in air, in general, POP concentrations are higher in urban areas compared to remote areas. In general, we can talk about a decrease of dioxin-like PCBs, but the bad news is that some PBD congeners are increasing, especially BD209. In the case of the white storch, we also found a reduction of PCBs, DDTs, and dioxin and furans in both study areas. Luckily, during the last year of study, we didn't find recent use of DDT, the original compound. So I would say that fortunately we are in front of a likely efficiency of a global regulatory agreement like the Stockholm Convention. But anyway, what it is important is that long-term monitoring programs are essential to understand the fate and to understand the temporal trends of pop in the global environment. Of course, before to my end, I would like to thank especially to the Spanish Ministry of Agriculture, Food and Environment, this is the new name, Magrama, and all the institution and networking helping us in, on the sampling campaigns, all the people who have been involved. And let me to remember you that Diocin 2014 will be held in Madrid on the first week of September. So I would like to welcome all of you to Madrid next summer, and thank you very much for your attention.